presentation will cover a little bit about the complexity of field devices, a requirement for information management, the independent device integration today, device communication and information interfaces, device diagnostics and structuring of functionality, and later on the design of an information shell and how we can realize this goal. Yeah, when you look at the field devices, devices are becoming more and more complex. Each people wants to deal with special information out of the device. So today we have different views from the operator, the technician, engineers, experts, and also the maintenance personnel who have different perspectives on the device. Yeah. Devices today often contains more than 1,000 parameters that must be configured. You can't do this over the display, but you must do some configuration because you have application-specific settings. You must set up diagnostics, yeah, so that device integration and communication must be stable for over 15 years where we want to use these devices in the plants. It must be suitable for maintenance strategies, MES, and also diagnostic and asset management efforts. Yeah, 15 years, investment safety, that's very important. That's a goal we want to reach. And when you look at the devices, you will see you don't have one device. You have multi-vendor plants with different devices from different companies, a lot of alerts, a lot of configuration parameters into the devices that you must handle. So you have a real flood of information which comes to you and which must be structured and handled by the different persons who deal with the devices. Therefore, we set up these three major requirements. So device integration must be independent from the communication and from the manufacturers. Device communication should be an open interface, and device diagnostic should become an information source for asset management. Let's look at the first point, how it is today. Device integration. We have a communication interface on one side, process technology, it's often Profibus, Foundation Fieldbus, but also HART. And on the second side, we have an integration interface, which is based on FDT, field device tool, executable code for the devices, or it's EDDL, a text file, which is interpreted by the configuration tool. Yeah, that's, and the first step looks very easy. But when you go deeper and you want to download an integration file from a vendor, you will see, you will also find the three different communication interfaces. But then you find really a lot of files, and you must choose the right file for your host system and for the device you want to use later on. That's a very high effort to do this. Maybe you didn't find the correct file, then you are not able to use the device. And that is the situation that we have today. So device integration depends on the host system you want to use. Yeah, the goal must be an independent device integration so that you have just one device integration for all devices which are used in the process industry, independent from the communication and the manufacturer. And that's the point where FDI, field device integration, comes up. On the one hand side, you have the EDDL side, which is very robust, independent from operating systems, and therefore investment safe. And on the other hand side, you have the FDT side, which is graphical, very flexible, and innovative. So we should combine these good points of both technologies and reach an independent integration of devices over device packages. And this device package contains everything that is needed to configure a device. It's divided in three parts. It's the EDDL part, that stands for investment safety. That describes the complete functionality of the device, including a small user interface. The second part is the UIP, user interface plugin. This is fully programmable. You can do all your graphics you want to make, and it's very flexible. And the third part are attachments, where you can bring in certificates and also manuals to use the device. Then you have one package that contains really everything that is needed to use the device. So you reach investment safety by EDDL and also the innovation by the UIP. Yeah, you use to take your different device packages, one for each device, bring it into the host system, and therefore you should use standard host components. That is important. And these standard host components are developed by the FDI consortium, by the FDI cooperation, to ensure interoperability of the different device packages. So you can reach really independent communication from manufacturers. The FDI cooperation, which you see here, is owned by the different organizations, by the Profibus International Organization, the Philbus Organization, the FDT Group, and also the OPC Foundation and the Heart Communication Foundation. It was founded in 2011, and the target is to develop the standards, standard host components, standard toolkits to create device packages. One part of FDI is OPC UA. That is very important, and I will point this out a bit later in the presentation. The standard is now able to download on the different host vendor, on the different organization sites. So if anybody wants to look it up, he can do it there. Let's take a look at the second point, device communication as an open information interface. How it is today? We have here a typical structure of a DCS system, engineering client, a database, a maintenance client, and all the data exchange between these tools is, of course, manufacturer specific. In the field, you have a standardized data exchange. You have standardized field bus protocols, Profibus, Foundation Fieldbus, and also HART, so that this works interoperable. But if you want to use a second tool from another manufacturer, which gives you better opportunities than the tools which are delivered from the host system, then you are not able to connect directly to the database of the host system, because the DCS system is protected like a castle. There is no way in to become this information. What you must do is you have to build up a second way, use separate hardware, build a parallel engineering and a parallel database to use another tool on this site. And this is what we do today, every day in every plant. The target must be that we only use one database for the field devices. And this is where OPC UA can help us. When we use an OPC UA interface at the host system, we can directly connect to the database of the host systems with tools from different manufacturers, and we get access over the OPC interface to the device information which is already contained in the host system. So this could be the future with FDI, the FDI concept for device integration. You have an FDI server and you can connect different tools via the OPC UA interface and go to the standardized database, and then you can use the software tools you want to use, which are best for your application. But also the host vendor has a possibility to increase his portfolio with tools he didn't have before. So this is really a standardized access to device information, but this is only possible if the host supports OPC UA. Another feature are electronic data sheets, e-class, pull lists, where you can use your pre-configured engineering parameters. You must bring them into the device. They are by the vendor on one side, and then you must transport it to the device package and afterwards into the device. That was before very hard work to do by hand in the past. But with OPC UA, it is possible, and the electronic data sheets, to transfer it directly via a ProList XML data sheet to an FDI client, and then through the OPC UA interface into the server and then into the device, which you see here. So you have a fully automated engineering process, and that really works will be demonstrated in March on a trade show in Düsseldorf. Yeah, let's look to the third point, device diagnostic as an information source for asset management. I'm sure you're not all familiar with NE107, which is the NAMU recommendation for self-monitoring and diagnostics of field devices. You see on the right side the detailed error message which is in the device, and this is mapped through a status bit which is transferred then to the DCS system. And all the major field bus organizations support today in their protocols these four status bits: failure, function check, maintenance required, and out of specification. And the big advantage is that you have a uniform presentation for all the devices which you use in the field. All the devices have different diagnostic informations inside, and you map them to the four standardized status signals so that everyone can very easily and clearly see what happened with the device. When we look how this information is used today, we will see this side. The information is mapped here in the device to the different status signals. They are automatically transferred via the protocols to the operator or to the maintenance specification. That depends on your workflow. And on the other side, the maintenance can go and read the detailed information within the device, but this is an active access, that it is not transferred automatically. And also, the vendor can, with his special interfaces, read out the detailed error information. This interface must not longer be when we use OPC UA, then we don't need it not longer. Yeah, in the future, we need an automated transport from the device information here to an asset management system. We need the detailed error that must be automatically transferred to an asset management system where we can search tech based on historical data and so analyze the real root cause for an error. Yeah, are these requirements possible today? Remember, this is a situation, information flood, a lot of things we must structure. And in the next part, I want to point out how we can structure the information that comes from a field device. Operator just needs the status of the device and the measured value, but the technician, the manufacturer, and the maintenance personnel, They all have a different job and they also need different information from the device. So how can we structure the data? Let's look at the task the people are doing. Maintenance must start up devices. It's doing simple error analysis, calibration, and it must be able to change devices every time when a device has a breakdown. And therefore, it's necessary that you have uniform parameter sets and functions, and a uniform presentation over all devices which are in the plant. The goal is that we have standard parameters for the different measuring systems. An AMO working group is currently doing this work, and then we will get device profiles and device style guides, and the goal is minor updates without impact operation availability, and that later on, of course, is investment safety. The technician's workflow is a little bit different. He is more doing process optimization and application-specific settings. He sometimes is looking at complex errors and doing a little bit repair. And therefore, he needs uniform functions over the different devices and detailed diagnostic information that he can find his parameters. He also needs a universal style guide, a user style guide in the usability of the different devices. And here we will have medium update rates. The last, the expert. Yeah, he is doing complex analysis. He often is a device expert from the manufacturer. He maybe is doing plant-wide reports for positioners, diagnostic with sensor raw values, which no other people can deal with. And of course, he has manufacturer-specific know-how, and he's using manufacturer-specific tools. And here in this part, we have the innovation, because device vendors want to adopt new functionality into devices to build up better products. So we have addressed functionality, an implemented functionality, and a usable functionality. For the maintenance personnel, basic functions during startup. For the technician, manufacturer-independent functions for process optimization. And for the expert, manufacturer-specific functions for complex analysis in the device. And this we can present in another form, which we see here. It's a shell model for information. So you have an inner shell with the basic functions that stands for investment safety, which are used by the maintenance personnel. A second shell for the technician, which has independent functions from the manufacturers. And the third shell, which stands for manufacturer-specific functions and innovation. So you can change parameters in the different shells without affecting the parameters in other shells. And this, of course, in all the three parts where the devices are used for asset management, device integration, and device diagnostic. So the people can concentrating on their task without unnecessary information. And of course, this only can work if we develop our device integration in a way that supports these three shells. Yeah, and that is our suggestion, therefore. You see the device package, which is used with FDI, and we can split it up into three parts: standard parameters, manufacturer-independent parameters, and manufacturer-specific parameters. Then we can update the single parts of the device, of the description, of the device package, and we isolate the updates. And that this really could happen, you will see there's a working group which is now working to define the parameters for these three parts, and it's done by end users and by manufacturers. And this is really the first step for an active information management. Thank you.